Righto. Welcome to Captain Dorja's Armory. This is Captain Dorja. Today we're going to be looking at another replay of the Type 59, and this is going to be a match that I played, not a subscriber match. I've featured a lot of Type 59 replays, as I've said, partly because I just drive it so much. But I've been driving the Type a lot in the last couple of days, even more than normal, because there's a bonus crew experience. 3x crew experience event right now, and as you can see, I've just gotten the 4th skill on my 3 of my 4 crew members, and this one here is at 99%. He only needs 1,500 more experience. I could probably go AFK for one battle and get his 4th skill, but I'm not going to do that because that's not how I roll. But I've been driving this thing a lot because these guys needed about 40,000 experience to get from 99 to 100 just like today when I started. But with the triple crew experience, I played like 3 matches with my crew, with this crew in the Type 58, and I played like 4 matches in the Type 59, and everyone is there except this one guy, and he'll be there in one battle. So basically he's got 4 skills now too, which is awesome. But what this video is going to be about isn't so much about the Type 59. This video is all going to be about the end of the battle. It's going to be about the end of the battle, what happens when you're dealing with Unicums. Unicums, if you don't have the XVM mod, you're not going to know what Unicums are. Simply put, Unicums are the best players in the game. I don't know where the term comes from. I don't even know what it means. All I know is that in XVM, when you see a guy who's got like a 60% win ratio, 1800 efficiency, you know, really, really high WN7, that guy is dangerous. That is a Unicum. Somebody with super high win rate, super high efficiency, lots of games played. So when people in your team start talking about Unicums, listen up. Because one or two excellent players can and will win matches for their team, unless you deal with those players accordingly. And in this match that I'm going to show, we've run into a pack of Unicums, 3 of them, in a platoon, in very strong tanks, and I know statistics can only be so good, but I can tell you right now that you don't get to be a 60% win ratio player, 1800 efficiency, you know, stuff like that. You don't get to be that good at this game just by stat padding. You have to actually be a good player. And on my team, I was the best player statistically, and I was the best player in effect in the match. And I'll tell you right now, we lose this match. And the reason why we lose this match is twofold. First of all, I had the right idea on dealing with the Unicums. I implemented it poorly myself. But all the while, I tried to get every single other member of my team to deal with the Unicum platoon at all. They refused, and we paid the consequences for it. So, you've heard my banter, let's get into the match. We're going to take a look at what happens when Unicums just destroy your team. So, here we go. Alright, so we're in the battle here. First thing we're going to do is we're going to pause the replay, and we're going to take a quick look at the team list. So, you can see the matchmaker. Let's get a good look at the matchmaker. Our teams are pretty well balanced. First off, we got the same number of tier 8 tanks. They have one more tier 7, and they have some tier 6s, whereas we have a bunch of tier 5 and tier 4 scouts. So their team composition wise is actually a little stronger than ours, but nothing we can't handle. So, nothing we can't handle. Now, you probably didn't see it because I was in team list mode, But the match has just started, and the first thing that I did is I said, watch out for the purple guys. They're really good. So, my replays don't play with my XVM stats showing, but I'm not going to lie. There was one other guy on this team that was above 50%. You know, I can't blow the horn of stats too much because mine aren't great. 53% win rate, 1,220 efficiency, 1,220 win 7. You know, that's nothing special. But, like, basically, everyone on my team except one of our scouts, I think, was either red or orange. And that means either... That means that you're either god-awful at this game, or it means that you haven't played enough games yet, basically, for it to be statistically significant. Which also probably means that in a Tier 8 match, you're not very good just because you haven't learned the capabilities of every single tank, and you haven't learned all the maps. So, statistically, it may not be significant, but it basically probably means the same thing. That's a little unfair, but it's probably true. Now, on the other team, you know, there were a lot of reds, there were a lot of oranges. I don't think, there might have been one or two guys that was green, but the key here is platoon number two, purple. Where's the third one right there? All three, these three guys. Type 59, AC 48, AT-15. First off, I saw that they're Unicums. All of them had 60% or higher win rates. Most World of Tanks players have hard enough time getting a 50% win rate. I'm pretty decent at this game, and I've never been higher than 53. If you've got a 55% win rate, you make me look like a complete jackwagon because your level of skill is that much higher. And I know this from playing with people like that. So, like, to be as good as these guys, you have to be good. You have to be incredibly good. If any of you watch the Mighty Jingles on YouTube, he's not that much better a player of this game than I am. But if you're familiar with Quickie Baby, these guys are all like the equivalent of Quickie Baby or Ike. Just phenomenal. So that is absolutely dangerous, and they need to be dealt with in the right manner, or those three guys will win the game. It could be those three against all of us. And if the 15 of us don't approach those three guys properly, we lose. The next thing that I notice is that they're in a platoon. Bad. When you have Unicums, that's bad enough. When you have platoon Unicums, that is horrible. Because that means they will work together. So, they're better than you, and they're working together. Third, they're from the clan Purple. Purple's a good clan. You know, North American server, they're called Purple Rain. You know, you don't screw around with those guys. Like, when you see them, pay attention. They're good. They don't let scrubs in their clan. So, you know, it's like three giant warning signs. Holy crap, Unicums. Holy crap, platoon of Unicums. Holy crap, platoon of Unicums in one of the better clans on the server. Yeah, alright, I think I'll screw around with those guys. Yeah, alright, I'll just throw the game away. So you get the idea here, it's like we're fighting the Borg. You need to approach it correctly, or else resistance is futile. So let's get the match started. First thing that happens is that guy's an idiot. You, sir, are in a crappy Tier 4 scout in a Tier 8 game. I am in a Tier 8 medium. Wherever you need to go compared to me is unimportant. I need to go there first. Guys, if you're in like a T50-2 and you want to jump in front of people, that's one thing because you're actually valuable. But like, if you're in a Panzer 38NA, I hate to sound like a douchebag, but don't get in the way of the real players. It just makes us angry. So, anyway, Raging Captain is going to settle down now. Targets are spotted. It's time to fight. So the first thing I see is I see the Yag Tiger 88, and I think, huh, that's a weird position. And I looked at getting a couple of shots onto him, but it was not going to happen. Next thing I do is I see this IS-6, and I decide to try and poke him. Luckily for me, he shot me at a horrible angle, had no chance of pinning. So I've got a freebie into that IS-6 for no reprisal. Now, I see this Super Pershing. Super Pershing driving 101. Don't sit in the open. Super Pershing driving 101 advanced. Point your front towards the enemy. This guy is... This enemy that I'm shooting at right now is bad. So I put two into him, set him on fire. He doesn't have a fire extinguisher. Alright, I'll take it, I guess. Three into him. And Pershing finishes him off. That guy was awful. So you can see, my team wasn't the only side that had some derps on it. Now this IS is giving me just an incredible firing angle, so I'm taking advantage of it, punching that IS pretty hard. Things are going really well for our team right now. We're rolling this north flank. We're you know, moving as a group, being very aggressive, and it's being pretty effective. So I roll in, and again, I've got the side of a Super Pershing. I'm going to take it. He only had 60 health left by the time I was able to fire, but still. Side of a Super Pershing, I always fire. Now, same thing. Rear of an IS-6, I'm going to shoot that all day long. Now, on Muravanka, this is the part of the match where things usually start to go bad. Getting into the magic forest is the key at this point. We need to get into the forest. And transferring your attack from winning right here to being over here can be hard. And this is what we need to start doing. We need to start just... We just need to charge. There's a big mass of us. There's only six enemies left. If we just all roll in there, there's nothing they can do about it. So this is where I start to make mistakes. I roll up to polish off this Yag Tiger 88, and I take three good ones from the AT-15. With his high rate of fire and high penetration gun, AT-15, every shot that he fires at me, it's going in. And he's just really smoked me. So you can see I'm hiding behind this house from the AT-15 and angling against the Yag Tiger 88 to take cover and kill him. Now, this is what I do wrong. My plan of attack right now is I'm thinking I'm going to move in like this and flank the AT-15. I know the Type 59's down here. I know the AT-15's here. That's two of the Unicums. The third one, the AC-48, is unaccounted for. I also don't know where this AMX or Slugger is. I'm assuming they're in here somewhere. What I was thinking was that I could go in here and spot everyone, and then flank this guy, and my team would shoot at all the spotted targets, and we'd be flanking this AT-15 so that he would die. But really, I shouldn't have gone this way. That was exposing me to the full fire of everyone. I should have gone this way and reduced the like effective field of fire against me so that, you know, it was only coming from one angle, not coming from everywhere. So that was my big mistake. The next big mistake, look at where my teammates are deployed. The AT-15 is heavily, heavily armored from the front with a very, very high rate of fire, accurate gun that puts out phenomenal damage per minute. Now, we do have two tanks with powerful high penetration guns, the two T-34s. Unfortunately, a T-34 sitting in the open against stuff with accurate guns with high DPM is a dead tank. The AT-15 will have no problem hitting their weaker areas and will just shred them. And at range against an AT-15, the T-34's gun, it's pretty easy to miss the spots where you'll penetrate and bounce. So even those guys shouldn't be attempting to fight from that far away. The Super Pershing and the Comet, those guys definitely need to get off their butts and get in close. The Panther is a tank that you almost never want to get in close with. But against the AT-15, you can't do anything from range. And the same thing for a Pershing. Pershing, you're just never going to damage an AT-15 from range. You have to be in close. You've got to make him turn, Like, you just cannot stand off and engage that thing, especially when you have no cover. So, let's continue. As I said, I made a mistake by coming in to where I did. I just took a lucky bounce from the AT-15. You can see where it hit, like, my turret ring. But the second one goes in through the side of my turret, and then I spot the Jackson and the M4. And at this point, I realize, oh crap, I shouldn't be in this position. We alpha the Jackson, and I start taking evasive action against those two guys and the AC-48. You can see he's got the 120 millimeter. He polishes me off. So I'm dead. Now, this T-34 here, he's got the right idea. He's trying to close in. But he's the only one trying to close in. They're just gonna focus fire him and kill him. And look, that's exactly what's happening. He's being focused down. He is now dead. Our team needs to flank that AT-15 at close range, or they will kill you all. That's what we need to do. That, like, victory in this match was so simple. We needed to drive from here to here to here, and we won. But as you can see, we are moving backwards. We are driving farther away from victory. We're literally retreating from victory into defeat. What we're doing right here is we are giving these two tank destroyers the exact situations they need in order to survive. And, you know, you've got this Panzer 30 NA telling me we may lose. No, we've lost. Like, if we had artillery, we would have still lost because we can't hardly even detect these guys. Right now, these two tank destroyers have every advantage in the book. They've got hard cover in the shape of ridge lines in the forest. They've got concealment and are very difficult to spot from range. You saw how close I had to get, and I didn't even detect that AC-48. He was probably only 70 meters away. They've got armor. Both of those tanks from the front, very well armored. They've got the gunnery advantage. They did not have the positional advantage. We could have flanked them if we'd done it together. And I was at fault there too. I made the wrong play. I didn't do what I should have done properly. But, I mean, I can only carry so hard. And generally, I end up having to carry every match that I'm in. Like, I get a little tired of having to be the only competent player. So sometimes even when I play good, I don't play good enough. But you know, the fact of the matter was, when you get into a situation where you've got a group of people, like, look, see what the guy even said in chat. Yeah, they did what we hoped they'd do, and good for me, and go for me. See, like that guy right there, he even said that what the enemy needed to win was for those guys to sit in the field and try a ranged engagement. If we'd moved in close, the AT-15 would have had to have turned his armor against somebody, and the other guys would have killed him. And there you can see it. He says in chat, everybody knows better than the only green on their team. I mean, what he's saying is basically they didn't listen to me, and I was the only person on my team who wasn't bad. So, I do have a post-battle results screen for this. Here you go. Here's our post-battle results. Now, look at this. This AT-15, 4,700 damage done. Type 59, 2,700 damage done. AC-48, 23.5. This AMX M4, 2,300. Everyone else on their team, nothing. These four people won the game. These four people beat all of us. This was a 4-on-15. But really, if you really want to look at it that way, this was a 4-on-2, and, like, this guy was half of a good player. This guy was half of a good player. This guy was a third of a good player. This guy was a third of a good player. This guy was a third of a good player. These guys were bad. So, well, I mean, we had a lot of scouts, so these little tanks, they're not going to do any damage. They're just going to run in and die instantly. So they almost don't even count. But, like, you know, I say that these four people were the only people that showed up to the battle on our team. Well, me and this Pershing were really the only people that showed up on our team. These T-34s, they didn't do awful, but they didn't do good either. But, like, but Armor right here, he did more damage than the entire rest of his team put together, if you don't count these three. This Type 59 did more than any of these people. Probably did more than almost all of them together. Same thing with both of these guys. So, I mean, to win in that match, we had to kill this AT-15, and we probably would have won. We still would have had to have dug out the AC-48, which would have been hard. And, you know, the Type 59 wouldn't have been an easy tank to chew up. But, like, a Type 59 that's really outnumbered is not a strong tank. An AC-48 only has 1,000 health, and they've only got front armor. This thing, two T-34s can alpha that thing and basically have it killed. It all hinged on the fact that we didn't close in with that AT-15. We allowed him to just tank all our damage and do 4,700 back. So, yeah, Unicums, if they're not on your team, you better deal with them right, because they'll deal with you. So, I hope you get the proper message out of this video. And that message is not that you should all go and install XVM and become stat crunchers, because in some ways, I think XVM has sort of made me a little bit of a worse person. But what you should take out of this, basically, is that if you're in a match and you see a guy start saying, hey, watch out for that T-29 driver, he's really good, and you happen to notice that the guy advising you to watch out for that T-29 is basically shredding the entire enemy team, you should probably listen to what that guy says, because they've got some information that you do not have, and they're trying to help you win. My team totally ignored my advice and lost because of it. So, that's all for this one, and we'll see you a little while later. Captain Georgia here, and just remember, guys, you can never have enough big guns.